gather for the dressing of an Elizabethan lady. Welcome to the Society of Creative Anachronism. The SCA is a worldwide recreationist movement and the largest of its type. We have been active for over 50 years globally and over 30 years in Australia. We are interested in anything up to the end of the 16th century, and today, brought to you by the Kingdom of Lockark and the near baronies of St. Florian de la Riviere and River Haven, and with the largesse of the Abbey Medieval Festival, we will be drawing the veil from the mysteries of the bedchamber of a lady in the time of Gloriana herself, Queen Elizabeth I. Please welcome our lady. The most excellent Baroness Akasha de Navarra, recently risen from her bed, already bewigged, made up, and wearing a loose gown to keep her warm while her ladies prepare her attire for the day. And of course, her ladies of the bedchamber. Ladies-in-waiting weren't just professional friends. These women were also trusted as discreet messengers, state spies, household accountants, personal stylists, and were just generally entertaining people to have at parties. There was a strict hierarchy to the ladies. Allow me to introduce you to them in order of rank. The highest ranked of ladies is the mistress of the robes, Baroness Jocelyn Delacour. The Baroness is the most intimate of attendants and is in charge of my lady's clothing and jewels. The Lady Neve of the Northern Reaches is the first lady of the bedchamber, a position that would have been allocated to her according to her family connections and not necessarily her age. During the reign of Queen Elizabeth, she had up to 34 maids at her call and was rarely alone, even when sleeping. But one must be careful in the choice of ladies, as it should be remembered that three of Henry VIII's six wives were ladies-in-waiting to the queens whom they would eventually replace. Our ladies here today are wearing a variety of kirtles and coats. A kirtle was a very practical, supportive base garment for most women and could be worn under a more elaborate outfit, such as a Tudor overgown or as daily dress. Now we call forth our lady. In the interest of brevity and the comfort of our lady, you see she is already wearing her undermost garments. These include a linen smock. A version of this garment has been worn by both men and women for generations. The smock was the most easily washable of all the layers, vital at a time when bathing was infrequent and considered dangerous to one's health. Hose and garters. The garters were, of course, required to keep one's stockings up, but could also be pressed into service as a very personal gift if she wished to single someone out as a favourite. My lady's shoes are flat, square-toed leather shoes, typical of the period. Our lady is also wearing a corset, or as it was called at the time, a pair of bodies. The Elizabethan corset was all about creating a flattened and elongated shape, originally lined in rope. In later years, this changed to reeds or whalebone. The first layer that we shall add begins with the padded roll. These rolls could be stuffed with cork or fabric scraps known as cribbage. This particular padded roll is actually quite a dainty version, as later Elizabethan rolls were up to three times larger, necessary to support the large wheel farthingales, which were fashionable in Elizabeth's later years. With the roll in place, the next layer is the farthingale. This item originated in Spain in the 15th century and was the original hoop skirt, used to support the full heavy skirts in the desired bell shape. It was rumoured that the farthingale was invented to conceal a pregnancy, which resulted from the indiscretion by a Spanish queen. The farthingale was introduced to England by Catherine of Aragon, Henry VIII's first wife, and versions of this are still in use today, most commonly in wedding gowns. Our next layer is the petticoat. The beautiful red linen we see here was chosen as the Elizabethans thought red was a particularly healthy colour and could help keep sickness at bay. I also like it. The petticoat smoothed the ribs of the hoop skirt beneath and added body and fullness to the final look. It was not unusual for ladies to wear two or three petticoats or underskirts to create the full bell shape. over the petticoat, we place the forepart. Essentially an underskirt, the forepart was often expensive fabric and the showiest part of the entire outfit, adorned with beading, trimmed or quilted. However, the frugality of Elizabethans meant they only used sufficient fabric to be seen through the split of the overskirt. After all, there was no point wasting good gold on something that was not going to be seen. Fine pins, which we see being used to secure the forepart to the underskirt, were an expensive but necessary item. And pin cushions were a prized item of a lady's wardrobe. Now for the overskirt. For those keeping track, not counting shoes and stockings, this makes 7 layers so far, and we are only halfway there. This outer layer of the skirts could vary in fullness and measure to the floor or curve into a train. The generous fabric is pleated onto the waistband, usually leaving the center front relatively flat and allowing the weight of the gathered fabric to pull the front split open. My lady's overskirt is of a similar fabric to her more ornate forepart, but they could also be plain, but still luxurious, and trimmed along the edges with a contrasting band, beading or embroidering. At this time, we add the partlet. The delicate partlet, often made of silk, lawn or linen, first appeared in late 15th century fashion. In Elizabethan times, they were often embroidered and pearled with small standing collars and ruffs, and could be worn directly over a low-neck smock or over the kirtle. The purpose of the partlet was twofold. It helped provide warmth or protection from the weather, while also protecting and framing the delicate skin of the décolletage. This will bring us to the bodice. The bodice here is stiffened and lined so as not to put stress on the delicate silk of the outer fabric. You will notice that the closure of this bodice is a row of hooks and eyes. Made of wire, they were originally called crochet and loops. Originating in 14th century England, they became very popular as closures. Eleonora of Toledo, for example, a famed leader of fashion herself, was buried in a bodice which closed up at the front with hooks and eyes. Lacing, of course, was still popular. However, for those who could afford it, they now preferred hooks. Sleeves were separate items tied onto the garment and were considered fashion accessories interchangeable between outfits and worn in varying styles. They may have been matching or complementary to the doublet, but just as likely to be made of strikingly contrasting fabrics. As you can see, they are also entirely optional, as Lady Akasha has chosen to go without today on this beautiful sunny morn. Now for our lady's finishing touches. We add jewellery as befits our lady's station, including necklaces, ropes of pearls, brooches, and a bejewelled belt. While she selects her preference for the day, we can discuss her makeup. After Elizabeth suffered smallpox, she began to cover the scarring on her face with a pale lead-based makeup, starting a trend for its use with a touch of red lip and colour to the cheek. The fashion for a high forehead and no eyebrows saw ladies pluck not just their brows, but their hairline too. Elizabeth is also responsible for the great popularity of pearls in this period. The self-styled Virgin Queen favoured pearls because they symbolised virginity and were therefore displayed prominently on her dress, in her jewels, headdresses, and even in her hair. And of course, because Elizabeth wore them, everybody else did too. It should be noted that Queen Elizabeth could spend up to 4 hours preparing for an appearance. We should hopefully be done sooner. The Elizabethan era saw an influx of exotic goods arriving from all over the world, including luxurious, never-before-seen perfumery ingredients. Explorers brought vanilla, pepper, cardamom, sandalwood, clove, and delicious cocoa. Most were used for flavouring, but they also found their way into fragrance creations. Lastly, the definitive Elizabethan accessory, ruffs. worn both at the collar and the wrists, were separate pieces of the garment added in the later stages of dressing. A lady's neck ruff could be tied in a full circle like a choker-style necklace or pinned to the collar of her bodice, as you see here. In Elizabethan times, these neck ruffs could reach great heights and often needed to be supported with wire frames to maintain their structure. This one is a relatively simple ruff made from silk, organza, and lace. It would take only about 5 meters of fabric and lace to achieve this lovely fashion statement. Remember at the time that lace was entirely handmade and very, very expensive. So this extravagant display was also about showing off an individual's wealth. The ruffs tied at the wrist, of course, displayed to all that my lady would do no labour, given they would be entirely unpractical for work. And now my lady is ready to attend her court function, suitably arrayed in appropriate garb. On behalf of the Society Creative Anachronism and the Abbey Medieval Festival, I hope you have enjoyed this glimpse behind the curtains of my lady's bedchamber and can appreciate the lengths to which our many reenactors go to share with you our love of history. Please thank our models here today, Baroness Akasha, Baroness Jocelyn, Lady Mee, and behind the curtain assisting with the items today, Lady Callier. If you would like to come and talk to our lady and her attendants about any of the clothing you've seen here today, or if you would like to take some photos, please feel free to join us in front of the pageant wagon here for the next few minutes. Later this afternoon, you'll see on your program a second presentation by the SCA where we will be dressing an Elizabethan lord. So if you'd like to know all the secrets about codpieces, that's what we'll be doing then. Thank you for being a wonderful audience, and please enjoy the rest of your day here at the Abbey Medieval Festival.